Hello friends, welcome to this presentation, and in this presentation we will be discussing about basic principles and variants of polymerase chain reaction. So few important things that to be discussed in this talk will be basic intro about PCR, historical background, and why it is a must have tool in the biology. So let us start with the fundamentals that were from idea of PCR or polymerase reaction originated. So it was in early days when Friedrich Mischer, about a century ago, he discovered that DNA is found in some kind of cells, and he named it nuclein because it was acidic in nature, so later on it was called as nucleic acid. Then somewhere in the early 20th century, in 1928, Frederick Griffith performed experiments on rough and smooth strains of bacteria, which were later confirmed by Avery, MacLeod and McCarty in 1944 by using protease and DNAs. And then few more experiments were performed by Hirsch and Chase. So these basic experiments, which I think all of you must be aware about, were all about confirmation of DNA as a genetic material. So it was known in the early days that DNA is a genetic material almost half a century ago or more than that. But the year 1953 was more interesting because in that year the structure of the DNA was elucidated, and there were several people who were behind developing this kind of X-ray diffraction. It was Gosling, Rosalind Franklin and Edwin Chargaff who were working on these areas, and they got DNA diffraction pattern. And with the help of that diffraction pattern, Watson and Crick, along with Maurice Wilkins, they together developed a model of nucleic acid, and that is considered to be one of the most important discoveries of molecular biology, and that paved the way for looking more into this DNA structure. So they were awarded Nobel Prize for this discovery. But later on, many people who are working in this area, they were interested in getting or designing this DNA artificially and creating in vitro DNA amplification models. So by the time when DNA structure was already discovered, there was a lot of studies which were going on and its mechanism of replication. Genetic code was discovered. So you may be knowing this person, Hargobind Khurana, who was known for his development and elucidation of the genetic code, that how DNA is responsible for making specific proteins. So he was the one who for the first time looked at the in vitro amplification of the DNA in a repair system. This was the paper that appeared somewhere in 1970. So this was the first evidence where people started looking at in vitro DNA amplification, and Hargobind Khurana can be considered as pioneer of that. You can see the kinetics and synthesis of one particular type of DNA that he performed by using 32 labels. But he was not very much successful in creating device or creating a machine which can do polymerase chain reaction kind of thing or in vitro DNA amplification. But much of the credit goes to another person who is a popular figure, and you can say he is the sole inventor of PCR, modern day PCR, and his name is Carey Mullis. Unfortunately, we had sad demise of Carey Mullis last year in August. But he was a person who started working in Citus Incorporation, and he mainly was involved in developing or synthesizing DNA by automated DNA synthesizer. So this kind of SAM1 DNA synthesizer was his routine work. And as you can see here, the raw material like nucleotides or other things were added to it, and it was more like peptide synthesizer in those days. So Carey Mullis kept on working on these areas, and he kept on thinking on how to perform and how to increase the efficiency of in vitro DNA synthesis and how we can do that. And in fact, while I was preparing for this presentation, I came through a very wonderful book that is written by Carey Mullis, Dancing Naked in the Minefield. So if you go through this book, you would realize that he was very passionate about learning, and he was an adventurous person. As you can see, the first few lines of his book, the sun had been hot on that day in Mendocino's country. Mendocino County. It was May. A dry wind has come out of the east. Nobody knew how hot it has been until around sunset the wind stopped. So he keep on doing some adventurous activities. And one night when he was driving with his girlfriend, who was also a chemist at Citizen Corporation, he had the idea of bracketing the DNA with a pair of primers and then thinking about how it could be amplified. So he was just calculating, if you amplify after cycle, you will get 2, 4, 8 and so on. So after the end of 24 or 33 cycles, there will be millions of copies of DNA molecules that will exist. So that was the story behind inspiration. Let's be a little serious about it. So if you talk about the research outcomes of what he thought, probably that first appeared in the year 1985, which was published in Top Research Journal Science. He, along with the Randall Psyche, they first performed the amplification of beta globin gene, which is associated with sickle cell anemia. So this amplification was performed in vitro for the first time by Kerry Mullis. And as you can see here, based on the same idea which he mentioned in his book, he used primer sets, and by using these primer sets, he was able to successfully amplify the DNA of beta globin gene. But unfortunately, at that time, the tag polymerase kind of things were not available, and they just used DNA polymerase. So the problem is, if you perform PCR that you already know will have a denaturation cycle and you have to ramp the temperature up to 90-95 and then bring it down to 50-56 degrees Celsius for primer annealing and then extension process. So at that time this extension process could not be done at 72 but much at lower temperature, which is equivalent to DNA polymerase. And what you will experience after each cycle, since you have 95 degrees Celsius temperature in each cycle, a significant amount of DNA will be degraded. So the degradation of DNA polymerase, you have to use a large amount of DNA in that process, and that was the drawback of this particular method. So in the same time, some people from Citizen Corporation and an independent microbiologist from America named Thomas D. Brock, he was again an adventurous person, and he had some visits to the Yellowstone National Park in California. So the Yellowstone National Park has got a lot of extreme environments, and in those extreme environment he was able to discover a bacteria that grows in around 90-95 degrees Celsius. He quoted, "Bacteria are able to grow at any temperature at which there is liquid water, even in pools which are above the boiling point." So with this inspiration, he published articles in Science in 1967, although it was much before than the paper which was published by Kerry Mullis. But the discovery of life at high salt temperatures also led to the discovery of enzymes which were present in extremophiles. So enzymes like TAC polymerase became popular, and then later on, team from Citizen Corporation confirmed and characterized those things. And as you can see here, another paper that appeared in Journal of Bacteriology in 1976, that was all about deoxyribonucleic acid polymerase from Thermus aquaticus, which later became famous as TAC polymerase. So this is the first evidence, as you can see here, in those times gel electrophoresis was used for purification, and those pure fractions were characterized by simple methods. And you can also see here in a snapshot from the same paper that how temperature affects the activity. So you would realize that it is somewhere around 80 to 90 degrees Celsius where it has the best activity, 75 to 80 degrees Celsius where it has best activity. So this was really a wonderful thing, because if you can have enzymes that can tolerate denaturation temperatures, then you can perform the whole process in one particular tube. And the work of Kerry Mullis kept on going. Now we also have the structure of TAC polymerase already. So after a couple of years, almost like after 3 years, when Kerry Mullis published his first paper, he came up with another paper, and this paper was about the use of TAC polymerase in the PCR machine. So you can see here the main results of this paper. As you can check, that relay number 1 to 6 here are representing, this is the gel electrophoresis pattern, and this is autoradiogram. So you can see here that the lane number 1 to 6 have got the amplification done by DNA polymerase, which is a conventional polymerase that's not thermostable. Whereas if you look at lane number 7 to 12, then these are representing TAC polymerase amplified DNA. So obviously, this was a great achievement that polymerase chain reaction could be confirmed, could be performed more efficiently with the TAC polymerase. So this was an important advancement in the discovery of TAC polymerase that appeared in 1888 in the science. So this was a historical background of how polymerase chain reaction process came into picture and how people started using it. Now we will discuss about different type of machines and how the advent of machines took place, and the machine of polymerase chain reaction is often known as thermocycler. So we'll discuss about various type of machines in a while. So now let us look at the different type of machines that were developed in the early days and their chronological order. So we start with one of the oldest machine of polymerase chain reaction that was developed. So that was named as gene machine, and it was developed by Inovonix in the year 1980. This, as you can see, this machine had got three water baths, and they had different temperatures maintained in them. One of them was meant for denaturation, another for primer annealing, and another was maintained for extension. So the three steps, typical steps of PCR, were carried out in different water baths, and there was a robotic arm that was capable of taking those tubes from one bath to another bath automatically. So this was the first idea of original PCR. But later on, the Cetus Incorporation, where Cary Mullis used to work, this, as you can see here, ProPTTE, this was the first prototype of polymerase chain reaction that was developed by Cary Mullis at Cetus Incorporation. And then this machine was further modified or further improved. So you can say this was the first commercial model of polymerase chain reaction, and that was named as Mr. Cycle. Some changes were then made, such as use of TAC polymerase and automatization, and this was made a little more user-friendly and simplified. So this new version that was developed in 3 years by Cetus was named as Son of Cycle. And moreover, after the cycle, the PCR machine that was much more closer to the modern day machines became popular as Blue Baby. That was developed in the same year, and this is an advantage of software integration. So they integrated software into it and completely automatized the process in that popular machine called Blue Baby. And then somewhere later, another parallel machine that was named as DNA Cycler 1 was developed by Perkin Elmer. Although this DNA Cycler 1 has got 48 wells, so 48 samples can be run at a time, but then immediately in the same year, Perkin Elmer developed another machine that's called Perkin Elmer Cetus 480 in collaboration with Cetus Incorporation, and that has 96 wells, so it was almost like modern day machines. Then more players came into picture, many more manufacturers started developing the PCR machine, and one of the famous manufacturers became Applied Biosciences, which still manufactures PCR machines, and 9700 was the first model that was developed, and it came out in the year 1989, just 1 year later. So you can see rapid advancements from 1985 to just within 4 to 5 years, this machine transformed from Mr. Cycle to ABI 1970-100, which is almost like modern day machine that all of you have in your labs. Then Applied Biosystems further improved the machine in terms of the capacity, in terms of the heating and other thermal properties. So ABI 7700 was another machine that was developed in the year 1992. Then Perkin Elmer came up with another model, which is known as Gene Amp 2400, and then Light Cycler in the year 1996 by another company. And an important discovery that took place in the year 1991 to 92, that was the development of flawless detection system. So you can see the conventional PCR machine, but it is fitted with a fluorescence detection system. So this was the idea behind developing a new paradigm in the PCR technology. And with this fluorescence detection mechanism, in the year 1996, molecular diagnostics came with a real-time PCR machine. That was the new advent in this particular era. So since 1996, we have further developed machines in terms of the efficiency, in terms of optical properties, in terms of the thermal properties. So a lot of advancements have taken place in the machines, and we have variety, almost like as many as hundreds of different models which are present in the market. You can see here the multi-gene Optimax developed by Corning. Then you have Thermal Cycler by Thermo Fisher. ABI is simply AMP model. And this is C1000 series by BioLED. Then MaxiGene by Axygen. G-Storm by Acrobus. Alpha Cycler by PCR Max. And more interestingly, the PCR machine has now been miniatured into a handheld or a palm carrying PCR machine. That's called Palm PCR by Aram Biosystems. So there are plenty of machines, and these all represent conventional machines or conventional PCR machines where you have to take out your DNA and put it in the gel. Whereas advancements have also taken place in real time in terms of technology. So this was one of the earliest models of real time PCR developed by ABI, Applied Biosystems. Then we have another advanced models like 7500 series by ABI and Quad Studio by Thermo Scientific, Q-Tau by Analytics Xena, and some qPCR machines are even portable like Marley PCR and Turbo Q real-time PCR by Blu-ray Biotech, Open qPCR single channel by Chiba Technologies, and you can see here highly portable or a handy device, My qPCR by Biomolecular Systems. Apart from that, there is another advancement which I have not mentioned here. That's called the RutaGene PCR machine. So where you have a simple plate and samples on the plate. So the problem with plate in real-time PCR is that you have to detect the process of each and every bit. And that causes a lot of hindrance, and it is difficult to measure the fluorescence of 96 wells together. So the RutaGene format, or another machine that was developed, has a specific mechanism that you place all the tubes in a circle.
So by now, we have already learned about historical aspects of polymerase chain reaction, thermocycler machine. And now it's time to look at the overall process. What are the components which are required in PCR while you are performing the experiments? So recipe of PCR is very, very simple, and it is made up of some essential ingredients. As you can see here, one of the most important thing that required to be amplified is your DNA, which is also known by the name called template. So you have to add your DNA of interest. Then you might have to add DNTPs, which are the substrate for enzyme, which will be added to new strand in order to get polymerized. And in order to incorporate these DNTPs, we have a polymerase enzyme. TAC polymerase is a special type of DNA polymerase, which we discussed already. It is thermostable, that can work up to the temperatures of 90 degrees Celsius. So it can withstand the boiling or heating steps during the denaturation. And every DNA polymerase is dependent on a primer or a template, so we must have to add small primers, and there will be two set of primers or a pair of primers called as forward primer and reverse primer. The design of primer we have already seen in the training. Now besides this, these components cannot only be dissolved in water, but they have to be dissolved in a specialized buffer which maintains the pH of all that solution, as well as it maintains the requisite conditions. So that might also have some essential ingredients like magnesium ions, which are prerequisite for activity of DNA polymerase. Now, apart from this, buffer has got a lot of ingredients, as I mentioned, that it can have plenty of things. Some of the most prominent components inside the buffer are magnesium chloride, which is required for the activity of polymerase, some ions which maintain the ionic strength, glycine, betaine, bovine serum albumin, small amount of DMSO, formamide for dissolution, non-ionic detergents, and a lot of other things which help actually in maintaining the consistency or density of this medium, maintaining the pH of this medium. So all these things have to be taken care of by adding suitable buffer, and nowadays these most of the buffers are ready-made and available in the pre-formulated composition, so you don't have to worry much about preparing those artificially. Now if you ask me that how much composition, what is the exact recipe and how much concentration should be added, so as such we do not have a very strict benchmarks for the standards, but as you can see here, some minimum amounts like 10 micromolar of forward and reverse primer, 10 millimolar of DNTPs, 50 millimolar of magnesium ions, and a little amount of polymerase in terms of the units. So these things might vary depending on your template. This is not a very hard and fast rule, but one thing that one must take into consideration is the total volume of the tube, because that is decided on the basis of the tube size or the sample size which can be accommodated in the PCR tubes, and that's somewhere around 25 microliters. So everything should be contained in this 25 to 30 microliter of the volume. Now if you look at the overall steps of the PCR, so it's again very simple. It's a series of three important steps. As we know that in order to polymerize the DNA, which is previously double-stranded, you have to heat it in order to convert it into single-stranded form. So denaturation is the first step, and this is eventually followed by addition of small primers on either side. So that step of addition of the primers is known as annealing. Followed by annealing, these primers are extended by changing the temperature, so they keep on adding the nucleotides and they lead to the synthesis of new strands in 5' to 3' direction. So these three basic steps, denaturation, annealing and extension, are essential component of any PCR reaction, and there may be several cycles, maybe 30 to 35 cycles of these three steps. The timings of these steps may again vary from 30 seconds to 90 seconds, depending on, it may also sometimes cross 1 minute depending on the template type and optimization, but usually this is below 1 minute per step. Now besides these repetition of cycles, there are few additional steps. One of them is known as initial denaturation, which is somewhere around 3 to 5 minutes, or sometimes even less than that. So what it does when your DNA is extremely large and this denaturation step is not sufficient, in that situation we must have to additionally give a step that's called initial denaturation, and after completion of these successful cycles we may have an additional final extension step of 3 to 5 minutes that may provide the completion of additional templates which are left over. Now besides this, suppose you are not available at the time of completion near the machine, you can leave in that protocol that after completion it may be ramping down to 4 degrees Celsius. That can be helpful for the storage and prevents the damage of any kind of DNA. So that's the last step, and these are the kind of steps which we may have to feed into the machine when we are performing polymerase chain reaction. Now another important aspect about the polymerase chain reaction is the geometric progression. What we already know previously from basic literature that when DNA amplifies, so what happens usually, one copy of DNA turns into two, two copies turn into four, four copies turn into eight. So there is an exponential increase in the copies of DNA after every cycle. This is kind of geometric progression. And based on this logic, you can say that after n cycles, the total number of DNA molecules would become 2 raised to power n if you have started with one molecule of DNA as a starting material. But suppose you started with a number of molecules of DNA as a starting material, then your total molecules after n cycles will be a into 2 raised to power n. So suppose you started with 5 molecules in the beginning, so after 5 cycles, or you will have the total number of molecules as 5 into 2 raised to power 5. So this is 5 into 64, and you can calculate the total number of molecules which are formed after 5 cycles. But there is some little discrepancy in this calculation, and there are few molecules which are undesired. So let's talk about that. If you look at the first cycle of any polymerase chain reaction, so obviously your template is quite large and you may be interested in amplifying a small portion of that template, which is known as region of interest or portion of interest. And your amplicon, which will be produced at the end of PCR, will be of this size. So in order to do so, in order to achieve this, what you will do is, the first step is denaturation. You will separate two strands of the DNA by heating them at extremely high temperatures. When they get separated, hydrogen bonds are broken down. The next subsequent step is, relatively at lower temperature, you anneal primers. So that's the primer annealing step. And when you add nucleotides are already there, when you allow that to extend at slightly different temperatures, somewhere around 72 degrees Celsius by TAC polymerase. So what happens during this step, the primers which were attached here, they start extending by adding nucleotides. And in this particular picture, you will notice that in the first step, or towards the completion of first cycle, you will not get the amplicon of desired size, because it will not end here. Rather, it will keep on amplifying till the end of DNA. So the new amplicons, or the new DNA fragments that you will get, will not be of desired size, but they will be known as DNA fragments of indeterminate length. So that's something interesting. At the end of first cycle, you are not getting your desired amplicon in PCR, which most of the people don't know. And here, if you look at the next cycle, then you would realize that in the next cycle again, you had two black colored molecules which are representing the original molecule, then two strands of the second indeterminate length molecule. All of them get denatured. Now you have four strands, and again the same process of annealing will take place in cycle number two. So here now this primer will bind, and this will start extending to this side. Again it will go up to the end and make a new molecule of indeterminate length, but this time the primer which binds to the blue colored molecule, which is of indeterminate length, will polymerize up to this place. So this is the first instance when you will get the desired amplicon. Similarly, from this you will get another desired amplicon. So you got a pair of desired amplicons which you are looking forward to have. And again, you got one more blue strand in this cycle. So total number of blue strands now became four. That means two molecules. So you can say the actual amplicon is being achieved only after cycle number two. That's not cycle one where you got desired amplicon. So if you look this into the more explanatory manner, I mean up to few more number of cycles, you will get a clear picture. Let's talk about cycle number zero, where you have the first molecule alone, which is the original molecule depicted by blue color. So here in cycle zero, you have one molecule of original length, no molecule of indeterminate length, and no molecule of desired length. But as soon as cycle one completes, you have one strand and one strand of original. That means total one molecule, because DNA is double-stranded, so one molecule of original length. And after first cycle, you have one molecule of indeterminate length, but still you don't have any desired length molecule. As soon as you move to cycle number two, you realize that one molecule of desired length or desired amplicon is formed. But still, number of original molecule will not change because that's not going to increase. Rather, you also experience that after every cycle, you are having one additional molecule of indeterminate length. So depending on how many cycles of PCR you run, the number of blue colored molecules or indeterminate length molecules, they will be equal to the number of cycles. So we can summarize this whole thing as, if you started with total number of DNA molecules after n cycles, so the formula is right, that's 2 raised to power n, where DNA of original length will be 1, or you can say whatever DNA you took in starting, if you started with A molecules in the beginning, they will stay as A till the end. But number of molecules of indeterminate length will be equal to number of cycles you carried out. So if you have carried out 20 cycles and you started with one molecule of DNA in the beginning, at the end of 20 cycles, you will have 20 molecules of indeterminate length. So you can also say if you started with A molecules, at the end of n cycles, you will have n into A number of molecules of indeterminate length. So if one asks you the question that at the end of n cycles, how many DNA molecules of desired lengths are available? So your formula will be reduced somewhat. It will not be just 2 raised to power n, but it will be 2 raised to power n minus n plus 1. Because this is the molecule of original length which you don't want. This is the number of indeterminate molecules which is not required. So you have to subtract this minus this to get the original number of molecules. So if I again ask you a question that what will happen after 5 cycles, if you started with one molecule of DNA, how many molecules you will get? So total number of molecules after 5 cycles will be 2 raised to power 5, that is equal to 64. But number of desired amplicons, which are represented by red color here, they will be given by 2 raised to power 5 minus 5 plus 1. That means 64 minus 6. That means you will just have 58 molecules at the end of cycles. But this formula remains insignificant, especially when you have 30-34 cycles. During the 30-34 cycles, this value will be in millions and billions. And this value will be like 35-36. So it doesn't hardly matter if you don't subtract this value. So people don't give more emphasis on this formula. But you should be aware about the fact that the actual number of amplicons is not exactly 2 raised to power n. So I have also given you a demonstration to simulate. This is a virtual simulator. You can open the link that I have shown to you already on your browser, and you can select various parameters like number of cycles. You can choose the duration, you can choose the time and everything, and you can add different volumes, and then you can simulate by clicking run PCR, and you can check the pattern of the gel that will be obtained. This is molecular weight marker, and you get the amplicon. So if you do some error here, your amplicon will not be obtained, and if you increase the number of cycles, the copies of amplicon will increase and you will have thicker band. So that can be easily demonstrated, and that can be virtually done if you just want to practice PCR at your own by simulating it in computer. Now, if I ask you that how many different types of PCR exist, there are plenty of different types of PCR, as we have seen in the beginning that machines are a variety of types. There are many different manufacturers of PCR machines. So there are hundreds of different models of PCR which are available. But in principle, based on the mechanism or based on the technique that is involved, we can broadly categorize PCR into three main categories. One category is known as conventional PCR. The idea of conventional PCR, they are low-cost machines, and they do not involve any kind of fluorescence system, and they simply amplify the DNA by using three set of reactions: denaturation, annealing, and extension. And finally, the DNA amplified DNA molecule which are present in the tube, they can be analyzed only in the gel. So analysis by gel, that is low-cost system. On the other hand, the emerging technique, which I told you earlier that it grew up in 1996, is known as real-time PCR. So idea of real-time PCR is that you don't have to wait for the complete experiment to happen and after that you run a gel, but while your experiment is going on, you can check whether your DNA is getting amplified or not by specific type of fluorescence curves that have been explained to you. And the point at which they cross a specific threshold that's known as CT value, which was informed to you during the analysis. Real-time PCR can also be further classified, depending on the different type of chemistries involved, into cyber green chemistry based real-time PCR, Tacman based PCR, or Beacon and Scorpion based PCR. So we will come to this in a couple of slides. Third type of PCR, which has recently emerged in the 2000s, and that is known as digital PCR. So that's somewhere more important when you are specifically emphasizing on colony, the count of DNA molecules or copy numbers, then digital PCR comes into play. I'll again get back to this digital PCR in the last slide. So this is the idea behind classification of PCR depending on the principles. One of the most widely method for quantitative analysis and relative expression of genes, real-time PCR is most widely used. Now, conventional PCR, they can be used in a variety of purposes, and there can be different ways in which PCR can be used by varying the design, varying the experiment pattern, or changing the kind of reagents which are being added. So depending on that, there can be more than 100 different variants, and out of some important variants include inverse PCR, where you have primers directed to opposite side, then nested PCR, where you reduce the chances of off-target amplification by creating a nest, so two set of primers are added there. Hot start PCR, where you separate the DNA polymerase from rest of the matrix and you allow that to get activated when you heat the sample. And then multiplexing, you can add multiple type of primers to carry out the reactions or amplification together, so you have multiple amplicons in the same reaction. Then you have touchdown, where you ramp down the temperature gradually. That's also to reduce the non-specific or off-target binding of the primers. You have colony PCR, which is based on rather than isolating the DNA, you directly add colony of bacteria and you avoid purification steps for the DNA. You have assembly PCR, which is used for connecting some amplicons or joining some amplicons. The primer have to be designed in such a way that you can do PCR chromosome walk kind of thing, and that's called assembly PCR. Then there is error prone PCR, where you use polymerase which causes error, and that's usually for inducing kind of mutations in the gene. So these are some of the commonly used variants, but besides these variants, there are more than 100 different variants of conventional PCR already known. Now, what I told was a limitation of conventional PCR is that you always have to wait for ending the experiment. So once PCR is completed, only after that you run a gel, and only on that gel you can check whether your DNA has amplified or not. The size, correct size of amplicon can be related with the use of molecular weight markers, and if there are more than one bands, then it may be representing the non-specific or off-target amplification, and that has to be checked. So the drawback is you have to wait for 2 to 3 hours to check whether your amplification has taken place or not. So in order to avoid this problem, in order to improve this situation, that what about you can check the amplification of DNA since the very first cycle when you start your reaction, and you can somehow check that whether DNA is being amplified or not. That was the idea behind development of real-time PCR. So in order to perform real-time PCR, what was done, that the normal plates which are used for the reaction, or the machines, they were equipped with detection of fluorescence. So every tube where the reaction is taking place, you have a basic mechanism that when a copy of DNA changes from 1 to 2, when it amplifies from 2 to 4, the degree of fluorescence which is produced by the DNA subsequently increases. So if somehow you can induce this mechanism of fluorescence with DNA replication, and you can have detection system for this fluorescence, you would be able to track the amplification in every tube. And that's what happens. We use some chemistries that I mentioned earlier, Cybergreen and Tacman, which we'll further discuss in a few more slides. So that chemistry basically is responsible for generating fluorescence in these tubes. And the optical system and laser detection system helps in recording the fluorescence. So you have some of light, and then there is excitation wheel that can focus this light onto specific wells, and then the light emitted by, after excitation, this fluorescence which is emitted by each tube is collected and that is sent to the detection system. So charge coupled devices, detection systems, they convert this light into current, and then that signal is sent to the machine. So you can say, if a signal is coming from this particular well, and if I plot number of cycles here, so let's say when the DNA amplification will start, after each and every cycle, when the fluorescence will begin to increase, this is going to take this kind of shape. So on this axis you will have fluorescence, on this axis you will have number of cycles, and this will be the shape of curve that will be obtained. So the progress of this curve can be monitored regularly, and you can check whether your DNA is amplifying or not. So this is how a typical curve will look like, and there is some basal fluorescence where DNA, even if the DNA is not amplifying, machine will show some basal fluorescence in that tube. So that is known as baseline, and the point when the baseline is crossed or threshold is crossed, that cycle where the threshold is crossed by the tube or sample, that is known as CT value. So the CT value is the number of cycle where fluorescence of a tube crosses threshold, and that is somewhere useful in calculation of relative expression that we will see in the training or experimental procedures later on. So after learning the basic mechanism or understanding of real-time PCR, let's talk about the chemistries which are involved in real-time PCR. The first important method or the chemistry which is involved in performing the real-time PCR is cybergreen chemistry. The name cybergreen actually comes from a dye which has this structure, and as you can see there are a number of tertiary and secondary nitrogens, and there are several pi electrons in these aromatic rings. So they are kind of capable of producing fluorescence, but one unique feature that is known with this dye is that it produces fluorescence only when it intercalates within double-stranded DNA molecule. So as far as this dye is free, this will not produce any fluorescence, but when it interacts with DNA, double-stranded DNA, it produces fluorescence. As you can see here, the fluorescence, green fluorescence of cybergreen dye, which gives its name. So what actually happens when you polymerize the DNA in PCR? Initially at one level it is in denatured step. So when you have denaturation step, all the molecules of cybergreen will be free, and in this free state they will have no fluorescence, they will not fluoresce. But as soon as the cycle goes on, the primer annealing will happen and there will be a region of double-stranded DNA. So this dye will start binding and it will start producing fluorescence. As soon as the process will complete, the extension will complete for one given cycle, in that situation, at the end of the extension of a specific cycle, there will be highest fluorescence that will be observed. So at this point of time, after each cycle, machine has got detection system, so it will fire a laser that will fall onto the PCR device in each tube, and then the fluorescence which will be produced will be recorded. And as you can see that after each cycle, the number of DNA molecules will keep on increasing, like 2 to 4, 4 to 8, 8 to 64. So this will keep on increasing, and as the fluorescence is directly proportional to the amount of cybergreen molecules bound, so after each cycle you can say here less cybergreen will bind, so less fluorescence, then more number of cybergreen will bind, and then even when you have more number of DNA molecule, more fluorescence will occur. So if you plot the number of cycle with fluorescence, you will experience that it will increase subsequently after each cycle, and you will get a typical graph of real-time PCR. And again, as we learned earlier, that the cycle at which it will cross this threshold fluorescence, that cycle will be numbered as or named as CT cycle. So this is how cybergreen works. But do you understand there is any drawback of this?
Yes, there is a drawback. Since cibercrene is not sequence specific, so even if your non-specific amplification is taking place, that means any other DNA molecule than desired is getting amplified, you will also get the similar pattern. So just by looking at this pattern, you will not be able to predict that whether your DNA of interest is getting amplified or any random DNA is amplified. So this is the reason people started exploring for different type of chemistries which are better than cibercrene, although the advantage of cibercrene is that compared to other methods, it is highly cost effective. So still, it is in use despite of the drawback. However, that drawback can be rectified by looking at melt curve analysis, and you can check whether your DNA of interest is getting amplified or some other DNA is getting amplified. Now the next type of chemistry is known as Tachman probe chemistry. And what happens in the Tachman probe chemistry, it is based on a simple principle of fluorescence and quenching. So let us try to understand that what is this fluorescence and quenching phenomena. First we should know that what fluorescence is. So fluorescence is a phenomena where a molecule, when it is excited, it gives rise to absorption of some energy. So you know that there are plenty of electrons in the ground state, and when they are given some energy, they get excited to excited state. Now if these electrons at some point of time, when they will return back to the ground state, they will emit the radiation. And if they return synchronously in many atoms together, then the amount of radiation emitted is quite significant, and this is known as fluorescence. Now what happens if the amount of energy which is stored in these molecules, in these fluorophores, is picked up by another neighboring molecule? Suppose there is another neighboring molecule that picks up the energy of this electron, excited electrons, and due to which this electron comes back to the ground state. So if the energy has already been taken up by another molecule, then there will be no fluorescence. So such kind of molecule which can take energy from a fluorophore and preventing its fluorescence, they are known as quencher. So we have fluorophore pair and a quencher pair. If they are close to each other, then there will be no fluorescence, and if they are far away, there will be fluorescence. So that's the simple logic that is used in Tachman probe. As you can see here, if they are far away, then there will be fluorescence, and if they are close to each other, then there will be no fluorescence. So this energy transfer is often known as can happen in many different ways. One of the very popular method by which energy transfer takes place is called as Foster resonance energy transfer, where it takes place non-radiatively. There may be contact quenching, where two molecules touch each other and then they transfer energy. Another one may be collision quenching, where one molecule, that is fluorophore, it hits another molecule, and that leads to the energy transfer. That's called collision quenching. So some of the most commonly used fluorophores and quenchers in the real-time PCR are 6-fluorocarbazine, and that is FAM, and another one is tetrachlorofluorazine, that is TET. Whereas a prominent quencher which is used in real-time PCR is tetramethyl rhodamine, that's also popularly known as Tamara. So unlike cibercrene, these fluorophore and quencher probes are designed in a way that they remain associated with a specific template DNA. So suppose we have recognized a region of our amplicon and we have developed a small nucleotide. Now to this nucleotide, what we will do, we will add fluorophore at one end and quencher at another end, and they will be labeled or they will be tagged at a very, very small distance so that quenching phenomena happens and there is no fluorescence. And this is known as a typical Tachman probe. Tachman is the brand name for this particular thing. So this is known as typical Tachman probe. Now what happens during the process of PCR? So just like we have seen earlier in case of cibercrene, there will be different cycles of reactions, and initially this probe will bind to the region of target interest, and As you can see here, this is bound. So in the first step, that is denaturation step, where DNA is single stranded, the Tachman probe will bind and this will not show any fluorescence. Even if primers anneal and the extension begins, there will be still no fluorescence. But the moment when DNA polymerase reaches the point of this probe annealing and it cleaves off the nucleotides, because you know that there is 5 prime to 3 prime exonuclease activity in polymerase that chops off these nucleotides, and then what happens, this fluorophore is separated from the probe, and at that moment it starts showing fluorescence. So you can say the moment when the extension will be happening, at that time you will experience a fluorescence. So again, after each cycle, what you will experience, that in subsequent cycles the number of single-stranded DNA molecules will increase 2 to 4 to 8 and so on. So in each cycle the number of probe bound will also increase exponentially, and after the extension the fluorescence will also keep on increasing to show a typical graph that you know for mass spectrometry, that you know for real PCR. And again, the value of cycle where this crosses threshold, that is known as CT value. So this is how Tachman probe binds. And since you have designed a probe specific to your amplicon, so if there is non-specific amplification, the DNA is being amplified in non-specific region, although molecules will change from 2 to 4 to 8 and so on, but since the probe will not bind to that region, so you will not experience any change in the fluorescence. So that will not change fluorescence too much, and that will be considered as non-specific amplification. So it is easy to distinguish the non-specific and specific amplification by Tachman probes, and that's the beauty of these molecules. Now, besides Tachman probes, people have also explored another way of developing these probes. Another one is known as molecular beacon. The name beacon comes from a standard beacon which you might have seen on top of vehicles. The shape of this probe actually resembles those beacons or the lights on the vehicles. As you can see, instead of having a straight quencher and fluorophore combination, like unlike Tachman probe, this is designed in a way that the region, the end part, has some complementarity. So since it will have complementarity, it will make a stem loop complex. The middle part will have no complementarity, but end parts will have self-complementarity. So this will turn into a stem loop complex, and these two things will become much closer. And as soon as you have DNA denatured, it is ready to interact with the complementary part. So in order to interact, this probe will now open up. That means initially it was like this, but then after binding it will open up. So when it opens up, the distance between quencher and fluorophore increases significantly and it starts producing fluorescence. So the difference here is that you don't have to wait for extension to happen. In Tachman probe, the fluorescence was being recorded at extension step, but here you can directly record the fluorescence at annealing step. That is the advantage over here. That's called molecular beacon. Now, besides this, people also developed another strategy which is called molecular scorpion. The idea behind developing molecular scorpion is that until now we were seeing that whether it is Tachman probe or it is molecular beacon, they were binding at some other region and primer was binding at some other region. So primer and probe were different things. But now what scientists did in molecular scorpions, they used probe similar to molecular beacon, and with the help of a blocker or a connector sequence, they conjugated this to primer. So primer annealing step means primer is connected to your probe, but as soon as the primer anneals, this part will find its complementary region and it will open up just like this, and your primer will keep on doing extension where the probe will bind to the region of its specificity. So this will also give fluorescence at annealing step, but advantage is you don't have to add these two things separately. You have to add only one thing, that is molecular scorpion. The name scorpion actually comes from the logic that how scorpion stings. So you can see the shape of this scorpion is more or less like this probe. So this is your probe and it has got sting like this. Now when scorpion stings, Its sting goes like this, just like in a way molecular beacon binds to the target. So this was the inspiration behind giving this particular type of molecule its name, molecular scorpion. Now these were the three principles of real-time PCR. Then another advancement which has taken place in the PCR is digital PCR. So how digital PCR is different from conventional PCR, we should understand in a way that in conventional PCR or real-time PCR, the fluorescence measurement is taking place altogether in a tube. That means there are like billions and millions of molecules. Whatever fluorescence they generate, an integrated version of that fluorescence is being recorded. But imagine, what if we synthesize each of the DNA molecules and produce a copy of each of these DNA molecules in separate small chamber, and we record fluorescence of each molecule? I mean to say that initially, if there were, let us say, six different molecules, so in conventional real-time PCR, the fluorescence will be recorded as an integration or sum of all these six molecules. But let us say if there were six molecules in digital PCR, so this one molecule will convert into two, this will convert into four, this will also convert into two, this will also convert into four, and so on. So what we do is we keep all these molecules separate and we record the fluorescence separately, and this is achieved by having a small digital a small chamber inside the tube which can accommodate only one molecule, so that you can see that if a particular molecule is amplifying, then there will be change in the fluorescence in that specific area. So this is very, very useful for particularly determining the absolute copy number. I mean, absolute quantification is an important feature of digital PCR, where we can easily detect pathogens, where we can easily detect the original number of copies in the DNA. So that's what is the basic principle behind digital PCR. And as you can see here, these are 60 micrometer cells which can accommodate only few DNA molecules, and they are then detected with the fluorescence. So this is the logic behind digital PCR. And I hope that makes my point clear. Let's have a recap. We have three different kind of PCRs. One was conventional PCR, where there was no provision of fluorescence, that had got several variants. Detection was done using gel electrophoresis, and that was only possible when your PCR run has completed. Then came real-time PCR, where you were able to monitor your amplification directly when it is happening, and the value at which fluorescence crosses the threshold, that's called CT value. That's the characteristic term which is used in real-time PCR for analysis. And third type of PCR is digital PCR, where you measure the fluorescence of individual molecules, and therefore absolute quantification is easier. In case of real-time PCR, we discussed about three different strategies or three chemistries. One was known as cybergreen chemistry, which is not specific to the template. Then two specific mechanisms, one is known as Tuckman probes and another one is known as molecular beacons, and when beacons are conjugated to the primer, that's known as molecular scorpion. So that was all basic from my side. Thank you very much.